Okay, it's working.
So we started right now a Facebook stream, I guess?
No,
no,
not the Wi-Fi is not good enough. Like, we need to adjust the record. So, yeah, thank you for the people who came. So we did a little test, so we wanted to know what's the cycle time from announcing the meetup to make the meetup. So this is just one day, maybe next time we will try 1 hour. Hey, it's great to have Armin here. Armin is CPO at Lunatax. And what I found interesting is that Armin has a UX background, so, and he will give a talk about how to do that in startup in the context of Lunatax. And then we have a second guest, and I will introduce later when we start. Yeah, so thank you very much for coming.
Yeah, cool. Hey. Yeah, my name is Armin. I'm working at Lunatax. Lunatax, it's a working like leading the product team of Lunatax. Lunatax is a software company. It's a startup still. I'm gonna talk very like a lot of the practical how we like apply lean startup in real like practical projects. And yeah, you can ask some questions like later on. So Lunatax, the company I'm working for, is offering an online software. You can do your taxes online for normal employees. We focus on UX design and try to make it as simple as possible. We're a startup, we're still small, we're 20 employees, about 1 year old. And our product team is quite cross-functional. It means we have developers, we have designers, we have tax experts and product managers in one team, and we kind of work quite closely together also with marketing and other teams. We love post-its, so we try to do lots of stuff with post-its, as also Stefan Jens like to do. So for us, and especially for me, lean startups is not just a method, but it's more like a mindset, right? It's more like a way to do things. You can also apply it to lots of different things. So lean startup for me also means thinking problem first, being data driven, and be iterative. Right? So I explain this a bit. The problem first. So the first question always: who's the user? Who's the person who's like affected? What problems do they really have? Right? What is the pain they have? And you should always validate this first. So always try to get proof on this. So if you have an assumption, you have people, I don't know what the problem was, they tried to fix here, but you should validate the problem first and then come up with crazy solutions to fix it. Data driven. For us, this means it's kind of also like for lean startup context, more like a question. So what's the cheapest way to get what kind of data to the assumptions we have? So when we come up with new ideas, with hypotheses, with a new cool product or something, we have assumptions, and data driven means, and lean startup means to try to get data for these crazy assumptions, right? In the cheapest way. Iterative, although like not incremental, maybe you're aware of this picture, so it means you should, when you iterate on something, you should do it like this. So first you build a scooter, then a bike, then a car, not like incremental in terms of building like the half of a car and then the full car. Right? This was the theoretic part. Now we talk about some actual projects. So we're going to talk about at least two projects we did in the last weeks, months, and we also we talk about the things we fucked up. 10% of the things did work and then 90%. One project is Fristverlängerung. Who is not German? For the non-Germans here, it's a very nice German word, Fristverlängerung. It's for taxes, so a tax company, that means some people are required, like they're obligated to do your taxes, right? They have some like a deadline, they have to finish it by end of May. And Fritz Verlängerung simply means you can extend, you can like apply to extend this deadline. Right? So you can go to the tax office and say, hey, please, I can't finish it, can I finish it in 5 months? Nothing. This was the hypothesis we had that we tried to build a simple online tool where taxpayers can apply for this Fristverlängerung, for this application, for this new deadline, to extend the deadline. They can apply online. This was the idea, and we offered this for free, and by that we kind of generate some leads. So this means we collect the email addresses from the people, and then we kind of try to sell them the text tool, right? So we give them this extended deadline tool for free, then we kind of sell them the text tool. This was the idea. So the old deadline, new deadline, you can do it with us. With this simple hypothesis, we already kind of implicitly have this five risky assumptions, or these five assumptions built up. So when you say this is what we want to do, right? We kind of assume that this is all true. Yeah, we assume that people even want to do to extend the deadline. Right? This is an assumption we make. We say that people have a problem doing it or not. We have some assumptions. And we will now look into this in more detail and see how can we get more data on these assumptions. Yeah, because this is kind of what Lean Startup is about, right? Getting data on assumptions in the cheapest way. So, assumption, people even like they actually want to do that, right? It's not that risky the assumption, but let's look how to validate it. We can simply like look at the search volume, have a look how many people are looking for this topic, and we see, okay, it's like 10 million people, and so, oh wow, many people, so there's a kind of high demand. We know the actual people want to do that. That's quite straightforward. Second thing, we assume people have a problem to do this on their own, right? We assume they need some help, they need an online tool for that. We validated this. Also, like we can look at existing solutions. So there are like three existing solutions. We can assume if there's a solution for something for a problem, we can kind of see if this is a real problem. Right? If other people already like successfully offering a solution for that, we can kind of assume here, okay, it's a real problem. So for instance, the first one, Text Butler, they offer a sample letter they you can print, and you can just fill out. It's a solution for a problem of extending a deadline. So this is also validated now. Then we have this assumptions. That's actually it's a quite risky one. So people they agree to give us their text data. So to do that, they have to give us the text ID. Text ID is unique. You only have one. Actually, I wouldn't give it us like with this tool because I'm a bit like cautious. But we might even could sell it in the black market. I don't know how much is it worth. But we don't try it. So this is a risky assumption. Yeah? Do they really, for this, do they really give us the sensitive text data? Also, do they agree that we can send them emails? Right? We want to send them emails so we can sell the text product. Question to you. How would you validate this? Yeah? How would you try to get data on this to prove it, that this is true?
Interviews.
You said it.
I said it.
You also talked it.
I can't say anything.
You're not allowed to give the solutions here. Okay, interviews. Something else?
I think you need something that people have really in the context, because this topic, when you are face to face, they will trust you, and they tell you something, but you need to have sort of like really product context where they are
not sure, like, maybe it works. The problem, I think, with interviews could be that, so maybe you ask, would you give us your tax ID? It's sort of like a theoretical question, and it's, as I said, they like me, they trust me, they say, yeah, of course, you look like, not like a scammer, right? Mm-hmm. I would trust you. I don't trust your online application, but I trust you.
I got an idea. You could do a concierge MVP where you say, hey, we don't build the service, but just give me your tax ID and I will send you emails whenever you need it. And here you test what people do. So they will have to give you that email and tax ID that you do it for them. And there you can test it.
So it would be like, we tell them, give us the tax ID and email, and we do it manually for you.
We do it manually, but then you need to get the data to do that.
Yeah, that's a crazy idea, but actually that's what we did. more or less, so our approach was building an MVP, right? MVP, we had this nice slide, so try to have a really, really, really small version to solve this. And always when you think of solutions, first fix the validate the problem, but then when you jump into solution mode, always challenge the solution, because and I speak about I have the experience for the last 3-4 years. In the beginning when I did this lean startup thing, my MVPs looked like this, right? Spent 4 weeks to build them. And after years and years and years and years, we realized how to build it in days, not in weeks. So always challenge your solution, always go more minimal. In our case, we did it in 2 days. So so we have a blog. We just used the blog engine, just created an article to say, okay, you can do the online deadline extension thing with us. The button, we don't have buttons in the blog, we don't have this feature, so the digital button is just a link, right? The landing page is really, really shitty, right? It's not converting perfectly, but it's okay. Then we use Typeform. Typeform is a software service, just costs 50 euros something per month. It's a form, you can just include it, they can enter all the data, and we had like a connection to Google Sheets, and we got all this data in the Google Sheet, and so each user is one row kind of, and gives us the tax ID and the postcode from the tax office. And behind we have this concierge. We didn't tell them that it's manual, but we have a manual process then afterwards. So someone actually looks up the postcode. So how this works is I have a postcode, and my tax office is depending on this postcode. And so we have someone, it's not me, we have an intern looking up for each postcode the email address of the tax office. This took about 2 hours a day or something. And we just manually look up the tax office email address, enter it here, and then we have a tool where we can send bulk emails to the tax office and just do this. Yeah, so we send an email to the tax office saying, hey, please extend the deadline for this guy. That's it. Yeah, we did it in two days, and now we can measure data. We can see what kind of data they're willing to enter, do they how many percent enter the tax ID and stuff like this. And then we can validate. Next one. It's the most important actually, also for the whole thing. We do this because we assume that the acquisition costs will be lower with this tool than with other channels. Again, how can we test this? Our approach at least was just to set up an ad campaign, get some real traffic on this MVP, and see how much it costs. There are some forecasting things you can do before. You don't have to set it up, you can calculate the expected costs. But yeah, you just set it up. Here it's really important if you do experiments like this, you have to have clear boundary, right? You should have like a time box saying, okay, we do this for 2 weeks, and after 2 weeks you should have results. You really should have a success metric in terms of, okay, I expect the costs per email address is, I don't know, 5 euros. Yeah? If it's higher than 5 euros, it's not a success. You should really have a success metric saying, at least it should be that. Yeah, doesn't it? Otherwise, if you don't have it, and you get some results and it's like 7 euros, and you, oh yeah, 7 euros, also good. You try to fake yourself into that it's working. Yeah, it's still in focus actually, it looks good. That it works. Yeah. Another project, Spafik. Spafik, yeah. yeah, Spafik, it's what the fuck is that? For the non-Germans here, BAföG is like it's a student loan issued by the German government. And so you're a student, you get from German government, you get some money for studying if you're poor. And we also have a tax tool specifically for students. As a student, so we also have some focus on students. Students can get a lot of money back from the costs from the university. And the hypothesis here is, so we built this online tool, again for free, where people can apply for this BAföG, and you have to apply, it's like, so we are tax software, we are in the industry of taking paper forms and transforming them in awesome online forms. It's the same here, right? It's paper forms, normally really, really, really shitty. And we transform this in an online BAföG tool where you can apply for this online for free. And again, we kind of try to sell them the student tax tool. Why do we do that? Well, to get some gold necklace. What is the next step now? So we have this hypothesis. What's the next step? I mean, you learned it already. Like, what should you do? What did we do? Like, you know, say
building MVP.
Huh? No, building MVP. You come up with risky assumptions. Actually, again, you should like this. You should really write them down. Right? Write down the risks. What do we assume here? Right? Implicitly, this is what you should do. Well, what we did instead is we just did it. We just built the whole thing. now we talk about mistakes. We built the whole thing online BAföG.de. Can have a look. But we built an MVP. Yeah? What does it mean? So we spent 3 weeks to build this, but we built an MVP. It means I believe this is the simplest online BAföG tool. Maybe not the best, but the simplest you can have in the German market. It's really, really, really simple. We don't support any edge cases, and we don't support any error validations. Right? It's really, really, really simple. But still, it took 3 weeks. Yeah, and then we put some traffic on it, and then we spent 3 weeks. Development time, we put 500 euros on traffic or ads on it, and what we got was free signups for the student tax tool. So in my definition of success, this is a huge fail. So we got like 70 euros back from 500 euros plus 3 weeks of development time. Actually, it's an epic fail. It's an epic fail. So what was wrong here? We didn't. And what could we have done, especially for a product manager, this is really like the, forget the 500 euros, but spending 3 weeks as a development team on this, what could you have done in 3 weeks? Not a lot. You could have done, brush your teeth or feel your feelings or other things, but it's really valuable time in 3 weeks. So what you should have done instead is, again, list the riskiest assumptions and try to break it down into the things you can then test individually, and on top, you should have the risk list, right? So this is the most important. Actually, I'm not sure if this is the right order here, but you should start with the riskiest in terms of where do you have the least data and what could like break the whole theory, the whole hypothesis into tiers, like into parts. Actually, many students search for traffic. We also tested this. We searched again, like looked at the search traffic. We also looked at this actually before we did it. But this one we didn't really put didn't really think about it. So we assumed, right, because we are experts in student taxes, we assumed we know everything, right? We thought the students which are doing BAföG are the same students which are doing taxes. And this is not the case. We know now, this is the only learning. We spent 3 weeks actually to learn this single thing. People, like students doing BAföG are not the same as doing taxes. So this was not proved. This assumption was not true. These two user groups are very separate. So you apply for the loan in the beginning of your study, and you try to get your taxes back in the end of your study. And so, is this kind of clear? So maybe in 2 years they will start using our tool, but in 2 years, I don't know what happens in 2 years. So that's why no one actually cared. So the BAföG people didn't care about the taxes because this is like in 3 years time. And then again, this is this thinking, and this is the really like a really important part of Lean Startup. So we spent three weeks, and the only real learning, the only real like result, success we had was this single thing. And then you start asking yourself, like how could we have get this lesson, this data? How could we have get this cheaper, right? And if you start thinking in this way, you start in this lean mindset. And always challenge yourself, how can I get specs on this in the cheapest way? I don't know, maybe you have ideas, I don't know. We could have set up a blog just writing about BAföG, trying to get BAföG users on there and try to convert them. This wouldn't have worked because again the users are too different. But setting up a blog is like 1 day of work. Setting up the whole tool is 3 weeks. And so we thought we are minimal, we thought we'd do an MVP actually, but an MVP can be completely different. So you want to build an online BAföG tool, but the MVP is a blog. Yeah? It can be completely different.
Of course. My question is right. The goal confused me a little bit, like you said, well, you want to build a BAföG tool. But what you really want is to learn to get people to use your text tool.
Yeah.
So by assuming that BAföG would be a good feeder into the text tool, you made an assumption instead of saying, like, well, I need more people using my text tool. And then you kind of open up this whole discussion instead of saying, well, let's build a BAföG tool. That's why I'm kind of lost here. Like, to get to it, why the hell would the text company build a BAföG tool? You know what I mean? So that's kind of why I think the assumption. Or basically, your objective was not to build BAföG, your objective was to get text users.
Exactly. That's also what we say here. It's a good question. To generate leads
for the text.
Yeah, because the BAföG tools are free.
Connection
to the text. So the initial idea was to get leads for the text tool. And we thought of different things, and we knew actually. So we looked at.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah, I just answered this. So we looked at this: how many people search for BAföG, and a lot, 10 times more than for Texas. That's
a lot of people search for Samsung Galaxy. A lot of people search for Samsung Galaxy.
Yeah, but
I mean, there's lots of people searching for something. Just searching for something doesn't mean that they require a text.
Yeah, I mean, then because this was the riskiest, this was the assumption we did, saying these are the exact same people. Yeah. Right? You also search for Samsung Galaxy, but also
I also try for Texas, so I need the assumption that
I'm not a student.
The Texas kind of put together is kind of for me, I don't get it.
Okay, it's it is a specialized tool for students. This we try to target students.
Yeah.
And we know BAföG is a student topic. Okay. Yeah, this was
target.
The link.
Target.
Yeah. Yes.
I have another question, because you also said that the MVP was an application for BAföG, which doesn't really have anything to do with taxes. So he only had 3 people signing up for this application to BAföG. Is it only proving that people were not interested in the application for BAföG, doing it the way you kind of offer it? Because it doesn't prove anything related to taxes.
Mm.
Right?
This was 3 people for the student tax tool.
Okay.
Yeah. So okay. The BAföG tool works fine.
Okay.
The BAföG tool is really working fine. We had like, I don't remember, let's say 50 users.
I don't remember.
Okay,
I missed that one.
No, it's a good question as well. But we don't make money with the BAföG tool, so we had users. So because this was true, right? We really have a problem with BAföG, and we were solving this. But for our business case, doesn't mean anything, because we were not able to get them to another tool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because they're not the same users. Yeah.
So, what would be a conversion that you would be satisfied with? I mean, you're saying I've got 50 people using my offer, so what's the assumption? That how many would you have to convert in order to make this a success?
Yeah, that's a good thing, right? So that's what I said here. When you do these things, when you do these experiments, you should be very explicit with your goal. And you should have set something up like this, saying, we didn't do it. But we should have done this, saying at least we want, so clearly the cost structure here, paying 500 euros to get 3 users, not customers. Our tool is expensive, but it's not that expensive that we can get the money back.
Yeah.
So it was clearly a huge fail. We quickly finished the lessons, and then we can have more questions. The learnings. So I actually kind of talk about it. First thing, it's really, really important to write risk assumptions down. You will miss something if you don't write it down, as we did. And discuss this in the team. Second, always what you just said. Yeah? If you do an experiment, define the success criteria upfront. So if you say, I can get conversion rate from BAföG to student tax tool, this should be at least 10%. Then you can try to get data on that. Always, as I said already, challenge your solutions, go minimal. If you can't challenge the solution on your own, go to someone else, they will challenge it. Yeah. Questions?
We have time for the questions because we have a lot of talk. So, 5 minutes, Max, so any questions you have?
I just comment. Thank you very much for this perfect example which is illustrating what we talk about all day. So it was great for me to hear that in practice.
Where we get the real data?
Yeah, it's just gut feeling, or what do you use to come up with numbers that...
How do we say...
Percent or whatever. Where do these numbers come from?
We have it here, one euro per lead.
Yeah.
That's a really good question. So I think, I don't have the best answer here, but I think to do it like to raise either bottom up or top down. So bottom up means in the example of, so our tool costs like 30 euros. I cannot pay more than 31 euros to get a customer. Right? So this is like the top I can pay. If I believe the conversion rate is 10%, then it's kind of hard to believe this. Maybe I have some experience on other things, or maybe it's just that's. I get the point, but it's really difficult to come up with reliable metrics saying it should be 10%. I think this is also okay. Maybe you're completely wrong, and it's not 10% conversion rate, but 1%. But 1% is also really good. think this is also fine. It's more about the thought process up front. Mm-hmm. Yeah, to kind of think about, so we didn't do this for Buffett. We should have done it, maybe we have never built this tool then. Because when you think of, okay, how much should the conversion be? And then you think of the whole structure, okay, but what's the sign-up rate, what's the submission rate, like for the tool, yeah. the conversion rate, what's the conversion rate from the Buffett tool to the student tool, mm-hmm. and then the conversion rate there. And then you realize the math stuff doesn't work, right?
Yeah.
The conversion rate has to be 70% mm-hmm. from one tool to the other. It's not realistic. And then it's, mm-hmm. So it's just more about the thought process, maybe, not about how accurate you see.
Yeah. So for your first situation, you use the blog technique to attract, or the lead page. Would you have done the same thing for Bafug, or would you have used another methodology to test your
So my point here also is like with all the assumptions, there's no silver bullet saying, yeah, always do a blog, always do a landing page. This is something I see people say, okay, lean startup means just do a landing page or something, right? It really depends, right? To validate this assumption, it depends really on the assumption. Maybe it's enough to do Google research. Right? Sometimes you need, maybe it's enough to talk to 10 users. Maybe it depends on the assumption. With Bafug, I would have done the blog thing because it would have fit. If you need data about behavior, kind of how many people will sign up, you have to start building an MVP. If I want to know how many people will sign up, I cannot ask people. I cannot ask 100 people, hey, would you sign up my tool?
It was a
difficult way, actually. So when I joined the company, it was still even smaller, and we had lots of discussions, actually. Mm-hmm. And we did some projects, and also the Bafug thing, we didn't really do it in a lean way. But people realized after project like this Bafug thing, which failed, that they realized, oh yeah, we have to change something. And then they were open to this. And I think now we like the whole company is very aligned behind this approach. To see the value. In the beginning they were always skeptical because it's not how people think you build